We conclude the ninth chapter. Ninth chapter, understanding how exalted God is, infinitely removed from divine attributes, divine wisdom, divine kindness. In a note, the Alter Rebbe explains briefly this idea of tzimtzum, of contraction, of the Ein Sof, contracting, hiding the infinite of God to allow finite existence to have a space in space and time. Before tzimtzum, before contraction, God's infinite manifestation predominated. Well, it was everything. Tzimtzum caused the contraction, caused for the capacity of limitation and finitude to come into being, because the infinite is being concealed to make space for the finite. This concept of tzimtzum, what did it first create? Is in the terminology of Kabbalah, here you can all become great Kabbalists now, is the idea of Adam Kadmai, primordial man. Adam, meaning man, Kadmon, comes from Kadam, Kedam, meaning primordial, first. It's the highest state of existence after Tzimtzum. And in there you have the primordial thought, which in that thought is in the primordial man, right? This is a metaphor, the allegory to understand, of in there, all of creation is in that original thought. And of course, from there, the subsequent contractions and emanations and creations and so on. This is the esoteric doctrine of Tzimtzum that's called Dikna. Dikna is actually an Aramaic term that means hair of the beard. What does it mean? Dikna means beard, and Saivra is hair. This is the concept of, think about it, the metaphor is a beautiful metaphor. You know, the most, the greatest thing that we have going for us in our humanness, I mean, besides the soul, is the brain, is our head, right? I mean, you want to, you know, connect with the inwardness of the person, you look at their face, you look at their eyes, right? It's allowing you a deeper connection. The brain that controls everything. And what's on top of the brain from the skull? Cut the skull covering it, but what's on from there? Hair. Or hair on here. Now compare the life force of the brain, right? God forbid something happens to it. Compare it to the hair. Hair you can cut. And in other words, the life force in your hair that's a part of you is so contracted, so limited compared to the brain. You do something, God forbid, to the brain, you know, even something that we see that does a trauma to the brain, terrible things can happen. You know, cut the hair, nothing. Why? Because the life force in the brain is so powerful, so undiluted, compared to how it's diluted and contracted and minimal in your hair. That's a metaphor for us to appreciate contraction from God. That process to condense the light, contract the light, so it'll allow now from God, from the infinite, right? Adam Kadmain, primordial man, with the original thought in that man of creation. And now comes that itself is already primordial man, Adam Kadmon, compared to the infinite of God, a great contraction, like the lifelessness of the hair compared to the brain, right? And what is coming from there? The divine attributes, divine wisdom, divine kindness, and the like. And this is where, when the Rambam, Maimonides, speaks about that God is the knower, the knowledge, and the known, that's after the contraction. That's comparable to the essence of God, to the hair that is lifeless compared to the brain. So that's the vessel of Atzilus, of the divine knowledge, the light in the vessel in Atzilus. And then from there, it's further contracted in the world of Bria, and even more so in Yetzira, in the world of Asiya, and then finally in this physical world that we all know and love, the physical world of Asiya. Now, God himself is infinitely removed from that divine wisdom, from that divine knowledge. That's the note. So God is infinitely removed, the Ein Sof, from the spheres, and yet those spheres emanate from him, right? And not only they emanate from him, but they're in a perfect unity with him. The Alter Rebbe says, think of the paradox. What greater paradox is there? Something is infinitely removed from you, and yet one with you. In a perfect unity, not as a compound, but as a perfect unity. It's a perfect unity. Wow. Do we get that? Alter Rebbe says, we have to take this in complete faith. We have no idea how to, I don't know. It's like me compared to the pen. Well, we have the hair, right? The hair is not a perfect unity with the brain, though. That's the difference. There's a distinction. There's some kind of, obviously, connection, but they're not a perfect unity. Or take, this pen. This pen is infinitely removed from me, and yet it's perfectly one with me. We get that? We say it. I said it. But obviously, first of all, it's not true. But God, the infinite, is infinitely removed from divine wisdom and divine kindness, and yet he's perfectly one with it. That's something we have to take with complete faith. And this is something we take complete faith because this is what the Arizal taught us, the concept that God, that he and his attributes are one. That he, the essence of his being is one with his attributes, even though he's infinitely removed from it. This is not something that we can truly understand. We take this on faith. And this is what the Holy Zohar calls the Rosa de Hamnusa, the secret of faith. In other words, it transcends our intellect. This concept we cannot grasp intellectually, but we take it on faith. We have metaphors to try to give us some kind of understanding of it, but in the end, it's not in our world such a thing to be infinitely removed from something and yet perfectly one with it. That's God and his divine attributes. And that concludes chapter 9.